Hello everyone, I'm Chef Umesh and today we are going to learn about aims and objectives of cooking. In our previous chapters, we have learned about vegetables and their classification. So let's move and know the objectives of this chapter. After learning this chapter, you'll be able to know about why do we cook food, what is cooking, their various textures, various consistencies of food, and different dishes, techniques used in pre-preparation and techniques used in final preparation. But before that, we move ahead. Let's know what is cooking. So I would say that cooking is the act of preparing food for eating by the application of heat. It encompasses a vast range of methods, tools, and combinations of ingredients to alter the flavor or digestibility of food. Cooking is the process of selecting, measuring, and combining of ingredients in an ordered procedure. Well, there are certain factors which affect the final outcome or the final dishes, which include the variability of ingredients, ambient conditions, tools, and the skills of the individual chefs doing the final or actual cooking. Cooking is an art. It is linked with the dietary habits and cultural pattern of people. Well, the intention of cooking is to see that food is cooked and it undergoes a physical and a chemical change at the end result is edible and acceptable. There is a use of application of heat and withdrawal of heat while cooking so that it can be made safer to eat, more palatable, and to change its appearance. Before we move ahead, we should know that there are certain aims and objectives related to cooking food. They are: cooking increases palatability, it helps to balance the meal and taste, it sterilizes the food partially and makes it microbe-free for a certain period of time, it retains as far as possible the nutritive and flavoring ingredients of the dish. It also gives a variety to the menu. For example, a piece of mutton can be used in a soup, roast joint, croquettes, stews, keema, etc. And as discussed, cooking also preserves food for a longer time. The high temperature used while cooking destroys bacteria and limits the spoilage. Well, there are certain advantages which are linked to cooking. For example, it makes the food easy to chew, it preserves the food, kills harmful bacteria, and it softens the connective tissue. Cooking makes the food to appreciable texture. Now that comes to different texture and consistencies. As we know, raw food gets cooked or exposed to heat and then it is known as a cooked food and ready to eat or consume. The term texture in itself is used to describe the characteristic of a finished or ready to eat food product. The final product will have a certain texture depending on the order in which ingredients are added, the way of mixing them, the method of cooking, etc. A correct texture has to be brought about in the food while cooking. A chef, which is quite experienced, should not only know the correct texture, but he should be able to produce the same in the food. The various textures can be described as firm and close, for example, biscuits, short and crumbly, naan khatai is a good example of short and crumbly texture, fat included in this, or the dough or the preparation of naan khatai breaks more easily into smaller particles. Then spongy texture, which is obtained or which we get in Swiss rolls, light texture in Madeira cake, flaky in lachha paratha, chicken or patties that we can purchase from local shops. There are certain other textures like coarse, tough, etc. Similarly, texture consistency is also a factor which should be considered while cooking. Various consistencies like different textures are found in liquid foods. Some substances flow readily, others resist flow, and some require force or weight application to start their flow. The concept of consistency is closely related to viscosity, and it's which is defined as the flow. There are certain factors which also affect consistency of a liquid. For example, concentration or thickening agent, temperature, to what temperature a gravy or a sauce is cooked, degree of dispersion, mechanical treatment, and time, how long is it after preparing. There are certain consistencies like pouring, for example, water and milk can be poured from a spoon or from a jar very easily. Coating, a sauce can coat the back of the spoon, then it becomes a coating consistency, dropping, etc. Now let's discuss techniques used in pre-preparation, which is mise en place, a French term for pre-preparation of things. Raw materials used in food production are mostly natural products. They are available in various shapes and weights. For example, we know that no two apples or no two potatoes are in same size, shape and weight. Similarly, preparing a finished product calls for basic uniformity in size, shape and weight. This is the base for uniformity in cooking and also appearance of the food. Breaking down the raw materials into required form is called pre-preparation. There are certain steps related to it, like washing, which removes the superficial dirt, then peeling and scraping, paring, cutting, grating, grinding, mashing, etc. After pre-preparation comes the final preparation or the cooking, actual cooking of food. When raw materials are ready to be cooked, they are sent to preparation area, also known as hot section of the kitchen, where it gets exposed to heat. There are certain techniques in preparation, for example, stirring. It can be defined as mixing two or more ingredients as they get cooked. Wooden, stainless steel, flat spoons, round spoons, perforated spoons, etc. of various sizes could be used to stir. Liquids as well as solid and semi-solid ingredients need stirring. Generally, it helps in even dispersion of heat, leading to even cooking. Other preparation techniques include masking, basting, tadka, or also known as tempering, are majorly used in kitchen. Sieving, passing through a mesh to remove impurities or to break down into even parts, or to enclose air. We have seen in our homes that mothers usually sieve the flour or atta before making it a dough. Now coming to our final slide of this session, we must know that whether there are any advantages or disadvantages of cooking. What is the effect of heat on different nutrients? For example, carbohydrates. Well, when we cook carbohydrates, what happens is that it brings some important changes in the physical state of that ingredients, like caramelization, which is the browning of sugars, and gelatinization, which occurs when starches absorb water and swell. What happens to proteins then? There is a very important reaction known as Maillard reaction, which happens majorly in proteins while introducing them to a heat of around 310 degree Fahrenheit. The amino acids in the protein chains react with carbohydrate molecules and undergo a complex chemical reaction. The result is that they turn brown and develop richer flavors. This is called a Maillard reaction. What happens to fats then? Well, many flavor compounds dissolve in fat, so fats are important carriers of flavor. When fats melt and are lost from food, some flavors as well as some vitamins are lost with them. When fats are heated, they begin to break down. When hot enough, they deteriorate rapidly and begin to smoke. That is the reason cooks are advised not to cook their food on high temperatures. Minerals and vitamins and other pigments also get affected due to the heat. For example, we know that minerals and vitamins are important to the nutritional quality of the food. Pigments and flavor components are important to a food's appearance and taste and may determine whether the food is appetizing enough to eat. Some of these compounds are soluble in water and others are soluble in fats. All of these components may be leached out or dissolved away from foods during cooking. So we should take extreme care while cooking our food to retain the minerals, vitamins and pigments. Well, at the end, we should know that cooking provides nutrition. It safeguards our food from different disease. It also stops the wastage or spoilage of the food. And it also helps in sustaining the environment, as we know that cooked food can be stored for longer duration. And with that, I'll end our today's session, that is aims and objectives of cooking. Thank you. For any queries, reach out to me at umesh.jugran@chitkara.edu.in.